no one is in control. This is something to know. Like, for instance, on this nanotech thing, if you read the journals where the breakthroughs are just happening week after week after week, well, then the question becomes, who is making this happen? Do governments want this? And they say, no, governments don't want it. It's so weird, they can't, they're just trying to come to terms with, you know, the computerized battlefield. And when you start talking about aerosol, I mean, no, governments do not want this. Does the world corporate state want it? You say, well, no, they're not exactly sure how you make money off machines that cost 1/10 of a millicent each and are distributed by aerosol spray. They're having a little trouble with it. So then the question is, who wants it? Why is this moving with such incredible speed? And the answer is, who wants it is the people who are cool enough to make it. In other words, in these research and development skunk works and think tanks, all the heads love it. They say, this is so cool. Look at this. I've got 16 motors running inside a tube 1/10 the diameter of a human hair. Check this out. So everybody's staying off hours and scratching their head and getting drunk together, and it's incredibly exciting just to see if you can make it do it. Meanwhile, the managers are saying, our whiter, brighter toothpaste project is falling behind while you people, they say, but don't worry, we're designing plaque-removing nanocytes that will live under your wisdom tooth and come out twice a day. I said, well, all right. And what it seems to mean is that, you know, information uses bright people. The thing that is the, I think, the unspoken truth behind human history is that you can't trust smart people. If you're the king, the prince, the pope, the bishop, the Lord High Chancellor, or whatever, you know, you need them, but you can't trust them. What does it say in Julius Caesar? Yon Cassius has a lean and hungry look. Such men, send me such men as are sleek-headed and fat, such as he think too much. You know, those thin guys who think too much. And they'll work for you, they'll appear loyal, but at the first chance, you know, they either run off with your bank account, your woman, or your technology, and maybe all three. And it was ever thus. So intelligent people are largely in the category targeted by psychedelics. And so, you know, you can't trust them to be heterosexual, you can't trust them to be unstoned, you can't trust them to vote right. They're just always slipping out of the corner of your eye and doing some horrible and incredibly subversive thing right under your nose, and yet you need them. And this is happening more and more. I mean, I go to these skunk works places like Paul Allen's interval in Palo Alto and all that. And they're just colonies of the most stoned, arrogant, smart people I've ever met. And what they're trying to do is produce weirder and weirder things for their own amusement. And I think they serve the zeitgeist very well. I mean, people say, well, they're spoiled and they're pampered and why, but on the other hand, this is where the first computers came from. This is where virtual reality and the glove and all that came from. It's where the net came from. Apparently, creative dreaming in the presence of technology is a place where haunted by genies, you know, genies that will wrap you in the blanket of their mysterium and lead you forward. This has always been known. I mean, alchemy, interestingly, is about, of all the traditions of the West, it maintains a kind of shamanic connection. The alchemist, the artificer, is aided by demons, D-E-A-M-O-N-S, the demons of artifice, Blake called them, and they teach you how to make things. But as was discussed yesterday, is it a con? Whose agenda does it serve? They only teach you to make certain things, things which amuse their demon aesthetic. And so, you know, our progress into the domain of techne has been at the behest of this unseen companion and its curious obsessions. But to make machines smaller, tighter, you know, the Swiss have been at this for a while, but you know, the best Pierre Cardin watch is gross beyond all imagining compared to nanotechnology.
That was the phase of his evolution that I sometimes think of as the techno phase. He was at that time preoccupied with nanotechnology and prosthesis and the use of various technologies to extend the capabilities of the human species to the next stage of evolution beyond humanity, the so-called post-human stage of evolution.
Perhaps with some amount of prosthesis, electronic processing, signal processing, I'm not sure what it would be. If we had half $1 million even, which isn't a lot of money, we could probably find out. But we need to build an environment where we can produce acoustical signals that we can see and play with in real time. And I've seen, and you probably have too, things somewhat like this. I've seen spaces that you could dance into and create a visual impression on a screen. In other words, a system of lasers is being interfered with by your body, and it's being uploaded into a complex hallucination-like piece of performance art. But I think we need to push on visual language. I think this is what these elf things want us to do. And that, you see, from an engineer's point of view, what we're talking about here is what's called bandwidth. And bandwidth is more and more the problem. Bandwidth is how fast you can move information between two points. And the more bandwidth you have, the more complicated and detailed the information you can move is. When I speak to you, this is one of the most inefficient forms of communication ever invented. We're going here at about 30 baud, 30 to 40 baud. The baud rate means bits per second. A standard modem operates somewhere between 14,400 baud and 28,800 baud. An ISDN line is 5 times faster than the upper end of that. T1 is 10 times faster than that. Bandwidth allows depth of field, and communicating at 30 baud with an acoustical signal of small mouth noises is just, it's amazing that we can crawl onto the theater of discourse and claim to be communicating at all. And yet, notice, we have built a global civilization on small mouth noises and the consultation of local dictionaries. In other words, we don't even have a shared sense of meaning. When I talk and you listen, and you think you understand, the unspoken assumption is that your dictionary and mine is the same. And since we're all English speakers, it's maybe 60% true, But since you're of one tribe and I'm of one from the other side of the planet, we don't even have the comfort of local associations. And so as you listen, you strive for a kind of internationalizing of your dictionary. And as I speak, I try to be as non-colloquial and self-referential as possible and keep and speak a kind of standard international English. But it's a feeble thing, hedged about by these kinds of limitations. If we could produce language sculpturally, a lot of the ambiguity would be drained from the system, and every iota of ambiguity that leaves the communication enterprise brings us closer together. I mean, our whole task is to make ourselves understood and to understand others as they wish to be understood, not as we wish to understand them. And so telepathy, for my money, is not hearing people think. It's seeing what people mean. And it may lie ahead of us in the future, springing out of our own technologies and neurological and physiological organization.
Here is the future. I represent the past, and I'm very proud of it. Goodbye.